Hello everyone, welcome to the third video of ISA Life Collections. I am ISA and I am here to introduce new ideas on philosophy, psychology, and neuroscience. Now, if you were with me in my last video, we talked about Plato's The Divided Line. Now, he believes that the highest knowledge a person can have and the ultimate truth is this idea of good. And he related this idea of good to the sun. The sun is energy, the sun is life. It is the reason why we can actually talk about a visual world in the first place. The sun is responsible for life and growth. And if you think about it, what comes through every single day? What is the most reliable energy source there is known to mankind? The sun. So if you didn't get a chance to see that, then you should definitely check it out. But today we are going to be talking about how social media is drastically affecting our brain and also how it can be affecting child development. Now, before we get into it, I wanted to talk about how prevalent social media is today. So in 2009, Mark Zuckerberg, the founder of Facebook, said that Facebook had over 175 million users. And if it were a country, it would be the sixth most populated country in the world. Now, it's 2019, and Facebook has over 2 billion monthly active users. Following is YouTube at 1.9 billion, and Instagram at 1 billion. Now, there's a lot of people using these platforms, and I definitely believe that originally these platforms were created to benefit the people. I think that, you know, they wanted to sell off this idea of global connection, you know, connecting with people from all over the world. And not only that, the people who fell off, friendships that fell off years ago, could also rekindle their relationships once again. And for current relationship standing, this could be used as a platform or a tool to kind of make their connection stronger. But it seems that we have come a long way from the origins of social media, and we fail to consider the negative implications that it is subconsciously creating for us. It's a different time now, and I think that we weren't expecting it to get this far. Now I'm gonna share some words, I'm gonna share a clip actually, from a former Facebook executive named Chamath Palihapitiya. And let's see what he has to say about Facebook. Check it out.
I think we all knew in the back of our minds, even though we feigned this whole line of like, there probably aren't any really bad unintended consequences, I think in the back, deep, deep recesses of our minds, we kind of knew something bad could happen. But I think the way we defined it was not like this. It literally is a point now where I think we have created tools that are ripping apart the social fabric of how society works. That is truly where we are. And I would encourage all of you as the future leaders of the world to really internalize how important this is. If you feed the beast, that beast will destroy you. If you push back on it, we have a chance to control it and rein it in. And it is a point in time where people need to hard break from some of these tools and the things that you rely on. The short-term dopamine-driven feedback loops that we have created are destroying how society works. No civil discourse, no cooperation, misinformation, mistruth. And it's not an American problem. This is not about Russian ads. This is a global problem. So we're in a really bad state of affairs right now, in my opinion. It is eroding the core foundations of how people behave by and between each other. And I don't have a good solution. You know, my solution is I just don't use these tools anymore.
I was rooting for you. We were all rooting for you. How dare you?
So Chamath doesn't even use Facebook anymore. He feels as if it has gone into a very toxic standpoint of false imagery and misinformation. For example, people may be hanging out with other people, not because they genuinely want a deeper connection with them, but mainly because they just want to do it for the gram and it makes them look good or better or popular. You do it for the likes these days. You don't do it because you actually want to, which is sad that it's gotten to this level. And so I know that we would all love to believe that social media is inflicting this positive impact in our world, and that it is truly contributing to individuals and communities that really need it. So I'm going to ask you, do you think that these social media platforms are really being used to make a difference? Well, you tell me. The most liked Instagram picture this day is of an egg. And this egg has over 53 million likes on Instagram. Now you're probably wondering why and how. So the sole purpose for this post was to dethrone the previous person with the most amount of likes, which was Kylie Jenner. Shocker. But so this was basically created to put someone else down. Not in a negative way, I'm not saying that they did it maliciously, but people put that amount of effort into making sure Kylie Jenner doesn't have the most amount of likes on Instagram. So imagine getting this amount of attention and this amount of awareness to something that truly matters. Something that will not only benefit our well-being, but the well-being of others. Thus creating a stronger global connection as human beings. Now that is something worth liking. So, how are children using these platforms? A small survey in Philadelphia says that almost all children, approximately 96.6%, have access to a mobile device. Now you're probably wondering, why is a child being able to play with a smartphone? And most of these children are given this access before age of 3. And by age 4, many of them are using it without supervision. So why? So 70% of parents say that they give them smartphones to occupy them while they're doing house chores. Okay. Now 65% of them are saying that they give them smartphones because it will keep them calm, so they won't be rowdy. And 29% are saying that they give their child smartphones before bed so that it can help them fall asleep. So, first of all, I want to ask, how many of you have seen a 3-year-old dominate an iPhone? I mean, knows exactly what to do, knows exactly how to navigate it. I mean, I'm 22 years old and I still am having a hard time figuring out an iPhone sometimes. So yes, I have definitely seen that many times. Now, how many of you guys have seen a 3-year-old uncontrollably crying, making a complete fit in public? And the only way for that child to calm down is if their parent gives them a smartphone. Now, I have seen this so many times that I got scared.
How many people were scared? Me too. I was really, really scared.
And it makes me scared for the future as well. Because think about it. If your child is crying excessively and you're giving that child that reward, so the child cries, the child knows when he or she cries, they will get what they want. And you're constantly giving them that reward, you're feeding them that reassurance. Think about how that will consequently affect them in the future when dealing with their own problems, how to self-regulate their emotions, and how to self-heal. It starts from when you're a child. And so if you are giving your child that reward when they don't really deserve it, that is teaching, that's a recipe for disaster. I'll just put it that way. Not only that, no matter if you're a child, adolescent, or adult, having a phone before bedtime and seeing that light will disrupt your sleep, because there is a thing, it's a natural chemical in our body called melatonin. And this chemical is suppressed during the daytime when it's light. But when it gets to dark time, we see that it's dark. When it gets nighttime, we see that it's dark outside. And our occipital lobe, electrical transmission is going to our occipital lobe and telling us, oh, hey, nighttime, it's time to go to bed. However, when you have a smartphone or television, for example, this is giving the same type of signal that it's time to wake up. It is suppressing our melatonin, which means it's going to be a lot harder for us to fall asleep. So, in other words, giving your child access to television and smartphones before bed isn't really a good idea. And as a matter of fact, it will disrupt their sleep cycle even more. And we know this because blind people have a very unbalanced sleep-wake cycle, because they can't tell when it's light or when it's dark time, you know? So just keep that in mind next time you decide to let your child watch TV before bed or give them a smartphone before bed. So now, how are teenagers using this? Over 95% of teenagers have access to a smartphone, or they own a smartphone, which obviously is making it very easy and accessible to be more persistent in online activities. And about 90% of American teens say that they have a social media platform, and it gets outpaced every year. So what I mean by that is that, say that the emergence of social media happened for this person at an age of 25. The next generation, it will be a 15-year-old starting to create their social media account. And the next generation after that, it'll be a 10-year-old creating an Instagram account. And the generation after that, it will be a 5-year-old. So we are outpacing age groups. And it is becoming more common for young children to have these social media platforms. Now, despite the ubiquitous presence social media is in their lives, 45% of teens say that it neither negatively nor positively affects them. It's just there. They don't know why they use it, they just do. A study with Royal Society Public Health says that social media has a correlation with depression, anxiety, poor sleep, and body image issues. In fact, anxiety and depression has increased 70% over the last 20 years. And it's gotten to a point where 9 out of 10 girls are saying that they are unhappy with their body and that they are unhappy with their appearance. So why could this be? We know, as we talked about in previous videos, that social media is false imagery. And obviously, teenagers are having a hard time to distinguish reality versus false imagery, because so many people out there use Facetune and Photoshop. And obviously, we're only going to post good things. We're not going to post about sad things. We're going to post about our most happy times. And so these teenagers are seeing these girls with the perfect hourglass figure. They see them with like full lips, perfect relationships, traveling all over the world. They are seeing people that are saying that they are living their best life. Now, first of all, anyone who says they're living their best life and they're saying it's on Instagram, they're most likely not living their best life, because if you really were living your best life, then you wouldn't be flaunting it and trying to prove it to the world that you really were. If you were really living your best life, you would keep that to yourself because life would be that rich. Just throwing that out there. Keep that in mind. When people say they're living their best life, they pretty much aren't. So, if teenagers are having a hard time distinguishing this false glamorous life, imagine children. I mean, God's sakes, children don't even know that Olaf isn't real from Frozen. So how do you think this is affecting children when they are having these social media platforms at age 7? How is this affecting them? And how will this consequently affect them as they're emerging into adolescence and young adulthood? We know that there is a correlation with depression and anxiety and body image issues. So we have to start confronting this problem. Now, adolescence is a very, very critical time period in our life. It is a period of biological and social transition, where functional and structural changes are occurring in the brain to help us navigate decision-making and help us navigate our social environment. But something interesting that we need to keep in mind during adolescence is that there is a dopamine peak going on in the striatum. Now, what does dopamine mean? Dopamine is a neurotransmitter, and it is responsible for pleasure. So this dopamine is being released in our nucleus accumbens, which is our reward circuitry area. And this dopamine is present when you're eating delicious food. This is why people stress eat, because it makes them feel happier when they're eating really good food, when they're having a hard time. It is also present during addiction, and when you're getting high from drugs such as cocaine and alcohol. This is why addicts become addicts in the first place, because they have this dopamine abuse and it feels so good chemically and naturally that they want more. And this is the downfall of what dopamine can do to you. You want more. Not only that, dopamine is present when you are falling in love. It is truly love on the brain. It really is. So this is why you get really happy when your significant other is around and when you're spending time with someone. This is why people want to be in relationships and love, you know? But as of recent, researchers are showing that this dopamine influx and this dopamine abuse is occurring with social media in terms of receiving likes, comments, or messages. We are getting this natural high from it, this technological addiction, if you may say. So with teenagers having this reward sensation seeking behavior because they have a natural high or a higher amount of dopamine in their brain as it is, this makes them try to do risk-taking behaviors. This makes them participate in more risk-taking behaviors. As we know, this is a very common thing that we know in adolescence. But it also triggers peer influence. Teenagers tend to be more swayed and influenced by their peers instead of kind of taking charge and taking a stand for what they truly believe in. Now, similar peer effects have been shown in other species, like rodents. For example, there was a study done to measure alcohol consumption in adolescent mice versus adult mice when the presence of peers or cage mates are around. So basically, they had these juvenile mice with cage mates with other mice around, And they found that the adolescent mice drank, consumed a lot more alcohol than the adults did when in presence of peers. So this is kind of reflecting this evolutionary standpoint across many different species, that this peer influence is occurring because of how our brain is wired as adolescents. It's happening with humans and it's happening with rodents. So try not to blame your teenager so much on following others, because they are literally wired to do so. So I don't want to put blame on teenagers so much on having this unfortunate addiction towards social media, because we can't help it and they can't help it. And before we can help it, we need to understand it first. Now imagine using social media every single day. That is also affecting our brain structure entirely. Like I said, neuroplasticity thrives off routine and repetition. So let me make this a little bit more clear for you guys. If you are a person who goes on social media and you feel worse about yourself, I mean, you are looking at these other people living these beautiful, amazing lives, and you're starting to feel bad. Well, I wish I had that life. I wish I had those things. And you're starting to negatively reflect and put burden on yourself for not being a perfect person. So if social media is making you feel this way, but you constantly go on it anyways, despite how crappy it's making you feel, you decide, every day I'm gonna check it. What is that doing? That is creating higher and stronger synaptic connections relative to those emotions. So you see a photo, you say, wow, I'm not skinny enough, I'm not pretty enough, I'm not good enough. You see these photos every single day and you're telling yourself that every single day. What do you think your brain's gonna learn? Your brain's gonna learn you're not good enough, you're not pretty enough, and you're not skinny enough. So now that we are aware of this, it is our responsibility to take care of our minds and our brains. And not only that, take care of our youth. We have to stop this negative self-talk. And it seems like social media isn't really helping us with that. Now I'm going to talk about the main research article that influenced me to create this video and was a huge impact as to why I decided not to post on Instagram for a year, or like roughly a year. So there was this study conducted at UCLA. And they had a group of participants. They were all teenagers ranging from 13 to 18 years old. And they were asked to come in, and they said that they were going to study social media use. That's the purpose of this experiment. And so they asked the participants to submit their own Instagram photos. And they are under the impression that not only are they sending their own submitted Instagram photos, but also other people in the experiment, other peers, are also submitting their own Instagram photos. So they think that they have that option to like the photo, and that it's just everything is just being built up in this like little community, this little bubble. And along with that, along with their submitted photos, the researchers also wanted to see how the neural activity will look like when teenagers are viewing risky photos versus neutral photos. So risky photos are like cigarettes, alcohol, partying, and neutral photos are like food and dogs and animals. So not only did the researchers want to see how the participant receiving a numerous amount of likes is affecting their brain, they also wanted to see what's going on in the brain when they're viewing neutral and risky photos. So, just like Instagram, they were given the option to either like the photo or press next. And they were under the impression that all the other peers in this experiment were liking or pressing next on these photos. But in reality, the researchers were manipulating the amount of likes that each photo gets. So it was very, very strategically done. This is a well-executed experiment. I will have the link down below for you to view. And so they did a bimodal distribution where they had a very distinguished pattern of what is popular likes and what is unpopular likes. So the popular likes are like 30 to 45 likes. The unpopular would be 0 to 15 likes. But to avoid suspicion, obviously they had to have medium range likes. So about 16 photos, 8 of them having 23 to 29 likes, and the other 8 having like 6 to 22 likes. This was to avoid suspicion, and so they wanted to see what was going to go on. And I'm not going to get in the nitty-gritty of this experiment, but I'm going to share with you what the results were. So, basically, it was no surprise that teenagers were more likely to like a photo, whether it was neutral or risky or whatever it was, they were more likely to like a photo if that photo had a popular amount of likes. Now, what they also found was that when participants viewed their own photos having many likes, they saw several regions being activated, such as the medial prefrontal cortex, the lateral occipital lobe, of course, hippocampus, and the reward and learning areas, such as the nucleus accumbens, which is the reward circuitry as we were talking about, the thalamus, ventral tegmentum, and the brainstem. But what's one of the most interesting things that they found in this experiment was that when participants were viewing risky images, they had significantly less activation in the bilateral prefrontal cortex and the parietal cortex and the dorsal anterior cingulate cortex. So basically, what this means is that participants were showing less activation in regions contributing to cognitive control. Now, our prefrontal cortex is the area responsible for decision-making, rationalizing, and reasoning. So when these participants are seeing these risky photos, there's less activation going on, which means they are less guarded, and it suggests that they will be more willing to participate in risk-taking behaviors because their prefrontal cortex, our prefrontal cortex is here to put red lights on us. It's here to say, hey, not a good idea. Let's think about this clearly. Not a good idea. Red flags, red flags. But when you're a teenager, you have less activation going on when you are doing risk-taking behaviors or doing behaviors that will stimulate your nucleus accumbens, the reward circuitry, as we were talking about. So yeah, this suggests that scenarios accompanied by teens are likely to engage in risky behaviors. Now, one of the most interesting parts about this experiment that they found was there was a significant greater activity found in the nucleus accumbens when they viewed their own photos having many likes. So obviously, a huge dopamine influx was happening. They're getting this natural high. As we were talking about before, this technological addiction, okay? And so if teens are receiving this type of dopamine influx, that's going to influence them to use the social media platform even more, to a point where there's no control. And what they found also when participants were viewing the neutral photos versus the risky photos, they saw that there wasn't much of a difference. So basically, when they were seeing the risky photos, there wasn't much effect on the nucleus accumbens. However, many participants in this sample had never tried drugs before, so that could be a reason why the nucleus accumbens, the reward circuitry, the area for pleasure, wasn't being stimulated when viewing risky photos. Now, if the teenagers did have access or experience with drugs, hands down, we would see a different result. Why? I don't know if you guys remember this campaign called DARE, or I don't know if it was a little bit different across states, but in Texas it was called DARE, and it was basically this anti-drug campaign to try to get adolescents and children not to do drugs. But actually, they found that when they did those campaigns, a significant amount of people did more drugs. And you probably are like, why? That's not the point. Well, the reason is because you're having all these images of alcohol and cigarettes and putting an X through it, but nonetheless, you are having those images out there. This is why recovering addicts can't have any triggers around them. If they see an image of alcohol, it will trigger them. Dopamine will be increased and they will want. They can't smell it, they can't be around it. This is how addicts need to heal. They can't be seeing that stuff because that stuff is going to make them want it. So it's kind of funny how DARE was trying to do this anti-drug thing and then it actually got more people to do drugs. But so yeah, if the sample was introduced to drugs before, then I think we would definitely see a different outcome. But basically what we can take from this, the main purpose of that was that your nucleus accumbens is being significantly activated when you are receiving a high amount of likes. Now I wonder, what happens to the people who don't receive the amount of likes that they get, that they want to get? So for example, I know that there's a lot of people who get really depressed when they post a photo and they don't get as much likes as they thought or anticipated. What's happening to them? I would really, really love to find a research paper because I don't think it's been done. In fact, pretty positive it's never been done. I would really love to see the effects of people. And although this is talking about adolescents, this is everyone. This is affecting everyone. It just seems that adolescents are more sensitive in their nucleus accumbens and are not matured fully in their prefrontal cortex, their reasoning area. But this goes on for everyone. I want to know what's going to happen in the brain for someone who doesn't receive the amount of likes that they expected. I'm sure there will be issues with the amygdala, which is responsible for emotion. And like we talked about, there's a correlation with depression and anxiety and body image issues. I'm sure that not receiving the amount of likes that you want is really, really affecting your self-esteem. So, what are the concluding thoughts on this? Your newsfeed is designed to be never-ending. Have you ever gone to the end of Instagram or Facebook or Twitter? No, because there will always be new information being fed to you of recommendations or things that you like. Now, the purpose of social media, they receive money the longer you stay on it, which is why they're trying to make it more as addictive as possible. And so it has to come to a point where you say enough is enough. And you have to say, how is this affecting me? But most importantly, how is it affecting my brain? How is my brain responding to this? And our brain is very mechanical by nature. So we have to protect it at all costs. And so, social media is designed and programmed for the consumer. They want you to stay on it as long as you can. They want you to be enticed by it. They are hoping to grab your attention. And it seems like this constant flow of information being out tends to be negative. Let's get real. We pay more attention to negative stories. We pay more attention to the tragedy than the happy endings. And that's just human nature. And so, like I said in my previous videos, all pleasure should be limited. And obviously, social media is giving us that pleasure. Obviously, there is a dopamine influx, this dopamine abuse, as Chamath was saying in the earlier video. There is a dopamine abuse being created here. And now that we are aware of this, we need to take a step back and reflect how this is harming us and what can we do about it. So, what can we do about it? I would have to say that YouTube is probably the most positive social media platform there is. The reason why is because it operates as like a search engine. So you get to choose the things you want to watch. And above that, it gives you recommendations similar to those type of video styles. So I'm gonna ask you, would you rather see videos that will help your well-being than videos that will hurt it? So instead of watching What I Got for Christmas, instead of watching a haul video, you know, instead of watching stuff, that material things that are making you feel bad because you don't have those things, why don't you start watching videos on psychology or how to self-heal better or how do I deal with mental health or anything like that? It starts with starting to help yourself. How are you supposed to help other people if you can't help yourself first? So we have that power. As consumers, we have that power when you are conscious about it. Now it's time to gain our freedom and our attention back. We have already become slaves of our own mind, and we have become prisoners of the system, of the social media system. And it's time to gain our attention back. They have robbed that from us. How many hours do you spend scrolling on something on a platform that doesn't mean anything? Will you honestly remember anything besides a funny meme, because those are worth it? But do you honestly think that you're going to remember everything that you see on there in general? So things that we can do is we can start limiting our social media use. For me, when I read this experiment and I started learning more about how social media is affecting my brain, I started to take a little a breather from it, because I started realizing, you know, and I know that we all go through this phase, and it's okay. I don't want to judge anyone for being an active social media user. I don't want it to come as judgmental, because I was too. It got to a point where I started realizing I was posting not because I actually wanted to, but because I was craving more attention. Because I knew if I posted something, I knew I would get comments in my DMs, and people would be like, oh, you're beautiful, you're funny, you're this, you're that, you're talented, extraordinary, all of above. So I liked that attention. And so I started thinking, you know, does it really matter? I needed to be happy with what I have now. I didn't want to start relying on social media to fix my sadness, because that's what I started doing. When I felt sad, I will post a picture because I knew that I would get compliments galore. And so I had to start doing some self-reflecting and realizing that I'm not using social media effectively or properly. And so that's why I didn't post for almost a year, because I didn't want that dopamine influx in my brain. I wanted my dopamine to be stimulated from other things. I wanted it to be stimulated from me playing volleyball or me having a very, very deep and meaningful conversation with someone, or in me reading a really enticing book, I wanted my dopamine to be stimulated in other sources. And that's something that we need to consider for our children. You don't want your children's dopamine to be stimulated from just a cell phone. Man, how many children go outside anymore these days? It's not the same. Now, I'm not saying that we're all doomed, but if we don't shed awareness and set limitations to this, then we might as well be. And maybe you should think about changing how you use social media and reflect a little bit. I mean, for me, I didn't completely delete my social media. I just decided not to post, because when I posted photos, that's when I realized the most dopamine influx I got. When I posted stories, that didn't really affect me too much, I realized. So you can start small. You can just decide not to post, but you can still be active on it if it's not hurting you. You have to think about what is affecting you. You need to get to the root problem, because it is different for everyone. Some people say that social media is a positive impact on them. So be it, you know, that's them. But obviously we know that there is a correlation with increased depression, anxiety, and body image issues. So we definitely need to pay attention to this and realize how this is affecting us. And like I said, everyone is different. But when I took a break, my little break, my version of the break, that really was the best year that I've had in my entire life. I felt extremely alive, and I felt my life had meaning once again. And now I try to use social media limitedly. Still. But yeah, so I know this was a long video, and thank you so much for fighting through all the way. I know that there was a lot of points to be made here, but I definitely think they were all very relevant, because we seem to be brushing these concepts under the rug, and we seem to not really be talking about this type of stuff. So I just wanted to create this video to spread awareness in this, so that we can help ourselves and increase our well-being. So thank you so much for watching. I hope you have a beautiful day, and I will see you next time. Bye.